Tak, tutaj jest, są ciasteczka domowe, piwo, jeśli macie ochotę, tylko proszę sprawdźcie datę ważności tego piwa, bo właśnie 10 minut temu się dowiedziałam, że w ogóle mają datę przydatności do spożycia. No. I zapraszam Kamila.
Okej.
Mam nadzieję, że nie zgaśnie.
Polski, angielski?
English.
Oh, sorry, English. Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, so how to start? So I'm Kamil. I was here in, I don't know, 2 months ago, something like this. So we were talking about GraphQL. It was a workshop, I think so. It was 2 hours long. I'm not quite sure, but yeah. The whole idea was to learn about GraphQL, and today we are here not to learn about GraphQL, but to see what are the benefits of using it, and what issues GraphQL is solving. So, yeah, the title of this talk is GraphQL as a missing piece of modern web application, and I just did a little fuck-up, so here's why. Yeah, and now we should start, but hi again. So, yeah, we were speaking in English, so that's me, like, something like this. Okay, and you can catch me on Twitter, GitHub, Gmail, I don't know, on the street, any type of conversation. This is my Twitter handle, like, for all those social media stuff. And, okay, so, the original title of this talk is GraphQL and Angular. I was talking in Berlin. I did the same presentation, so standing on the NG moon with Apollo. But since like this is NG-Poznan, so we were talking about Angular. But all the stuff I will say, it's pretty much the same for most of the frameworks. So the title should be GraphQL and any framework running on the every moon with Apollo. So let's get started. So today, let's talk about the current state of web applications. So we use components, like everyone knows components, which is like the basic unit of every application. And we do this to, just touch for some time to not, you know, disable the icon. So we use components. Components is a basic unit of our application, which is can be isolated, and it has an input, output, and stuff, which you are probably familiar with. And it makes our living much easier because we can develop it faster, maintain all the components perfectly, and reuse them, which is very very important and convenient. And even the app itself is a component, so we no longer have to debug all the application like from the very beginning to the very end, just like a whole unit. We can split it into the separate parts. And yeah, and this is like the basic component in Angular, which as you can see, this is the component we will use later on to show, you know, benefits and differences of using GraphQL and REST and other endpoints, the other API structures. So it's a comment, it displays the helper and a text. So it has an input, and this input is a type of component, of comment. It's an helper and text, and this is how it looks. But it takes something, so we have to provide something to display this inside this component. So we call it data. And yeah, so how to fetch the data from the API? You can just put the HTTP request, HTTP service, and get this data from the API server and assign this value directly to the component, to one of the properties. And this is good. But as you all know, we use like there is a problem, and let's look, like, where is the problem? The problem is with the data. Yes, yes. Okay, so we have to do this. Or not. So the problem is with the data, the managing state and to provide the data and so on. So it's not ideal right now, and like, there are plenty of developers, plenty of companies that uses Angular and all the frameworks. So there must be a way, and the better way is splitting the this dumb smart component thing. So we split the components into smart components and dumb components, and which stands for container and presentational part. And what is it and what it does? So what it means, smart and dumb components. So we have two components where like all the logic and all the data providing is on inside the smart component, and we pass this data from the smart component that includes the dumb component, another component, and we pass the data just to display it. So yeah, it's very simple. And back to the example. So this is our example. We use this input that needs an ID of the component, L of the comment. We hit the server, we get the data, we pass the data into the UI. So let's make it dumb. This is how it would look like. We just added the input decorator on top of the component property. And that's it. So let's make the smart component. So as the brain, we have this template that we use the component, the common component, and we pass the data asynchronously. Using this observable that came from the HTTP service. So we did the same thing, but we split the logic and the display part to separate component. So it's not still a good idea. And yeah, so we end up using services to manage the state, to manage all the logic, and we love them, like we use this all the time. And this is how it took place. So we created a comments API service we provided to the smart component, and we fetch the data using this single method. And yeah, pretty much all the services works like that. But yeah, and we are done, like everybody now is supposed to be happy, but yeah, except your clients and your developers. So let's see what are the problems of this approach. So, and now, okay. So we have this issue with overloaded network, which means that, imagine a situation when each component hits the server. So we make a request, and we make, like we have hundreds of components, so we end up with hundreds of HTTP requests. So we hit the API, and even on the mobile devices, it's not a good idea to hit the server that many times. We could use just the one request and stuff, but And let's talk about different problem. So we have also those unnecessary requests. So imagine a situation when we have two components that share the same data. So we fetch this data twice, and we could avoid it. Like we will talk about these solutions later on. So, and it's also a problem. We end up with two the same components fetching data from, say, as in this example, to the comment of number three. And there is also an issue with inconsistent data. So imagine a situation when you have the same comment displayed, displayed the same data two separated parts in your application, and you fetch one like here, and when you switch the route to another route, or you have a delay between rendering one component and second component, and you hit the server twice with a delay, and there's an action in between them. So let's imagine that you have a comment and second component, and those supposed to be the same data, the same data supposed to be in those components, but someone liked the comment, so now number of the likes are pretty different, because we have plus one, and so it's an issue. And next thing is overfetched data. So with REST endpoint, and you guys probably are familiar with API from GitHub, and when you fetch something, there is plenty of things that you won't even use. And the basic example, will be in a minute or less.
Yeah.
So we fetch, like, this is, let's say this is our component. We have the text and we have the author. And we fetch data from the some endpoint. It's not supposed, like, it could be REST, but it's not required. So we fetch this text posted by, which text stands for the content, posted by for the author, data creation, and also number of links. So as you can see, we use only two of them. So we can, like, put any other data into the trash immediately because, you know, we no longer use it. And even on the mobile devices, size matters because you fetch tons of bytes that you won't even use. And this is a mobile network, so, you know, it's an issue. So another thing with REST, like with current approach using API, we have to do adjustments. So the data structure that comes from the API, it's not super great for our UI use case. So we have to, you know, manipulate the data. And this is like a very basic example. So we have contents and also the author, but we in our UI we use, as you can see, text and posted by. So it's pretty simple, but imagine a situation when we use like different structure. So we no longer have like an RI or something like this. So it could be quite difficult. And I think the last thing, but I'm not quite sure, is that client depends on API. So every change on site on the API requires a change inside all the apps that uses this API. So every time you use something, every time you make a change, you have to be sure that it's not like it won't broke any application that uses the API. So this is a huge pain in the ass because you have to use versioning and to maintain all the versions, and it's like a terrible idea. So let's talk about solutions. So we can talk about GraphQL, and I will do, like, how many of you are familiar with GraphQL? Yeah, so this is a good idea that I put these slides with GraphQL inside this presentation. So yeah, for else of you, it's like, what the fuck? So GraphQL is just a brief introduction. It's a data query language. So it's like when you use MySQL and stuff like this, you have this select something from something, where something, etc. So you have this query language. And then it was invented by Facebook in 2012, and they used it inside their application internally. And then they open sourced it in May, I think, in 2015. So, and the idea behind this GraphQL, the original idea was that the mobile application for iOS and Android, like everything, I was talking about. Yeah, so like this basic idea is like idea behind the GraphQL is that they have to come up with solutions to fetch, like to optimize the API request inside the mobile application. So this is why they invented GraphQL. And yeah, basically this GraphQL fulfills the need of these modern web application needs. So, but we will talk about this later on. So this is how GraphQL, so this is how GraphQL works and where it lives. So you have this server side and client side, and imagine that there is no GraphQL in between. So every time you want to fetch something from your web desktop mobile device or application, you have to hit the external API or database, but you get the endpoint, and this endpoint uses this, it fetches data from microservices databases or even other APIs. So, and GraphQL, and so you get this versioning and stuff, like all these things I talked about recently. So with GraphQL is actually, it's not a replacement for all these things, it lives in between. So every time you make a request, that is a GraphQL query, and it's being interpreted in on the server side, and then you resolve the data, which we did in workshop. Resolve the data with this data from that comes from microservices, databases, internal API, etc. And yeah, so what to add here? So we can also, like, this GraphQL query is not specific to the platform, so you can use just a basic HTTP request that came from, I don't know, Arduino, mobile, anything. Like, this is just a string, so you can use it with any device. And you don't even have to use like client library to handle the query, just a string. So yeah, so let's see what I've got to you. And this is how it looks. So this is a simple query. It's pretty much the same like a JSON object, so you can think of it that way, like a simple plain object from JSON. This is basically the same structure. So yeah, so this is an example. This is the hello world of the GraphQL. So you fetch the, like, imagine that me stands for this field. Like, this is a field, this is a field, this field can be extended with another field, and so on. You can even use me, you, us, whatever, like anything you want. And each field is resolved. Like, you have, for each field, there is a separate resolver. So you can handle, like, you know, think of it as a, in quotes, as an endpoint. So this is endpoint, but they can be combined into just one endpoint, which is a GraphQL endpoint, and that's it. So me stands for, I don't know, maybe currently logged in user. Name is just a name of that user. And when you fetch this, you get the same response, which we, yeah, which I will show you here. So how many of you are familiar with TypeScript? Like, probably most of, yeah. So this looks pretty much the same, basically. This is just a type system, and it's pretty convenient, especially for GraphQL and that kind of stuff. So you create a type. This type is a project. You get the name, tagline, contributors, and as you can see, this project stands for a project inside, like, let's say, GitHub. So we put here the name of the project, tagline, and contributors. Contributors, it's an array of user types. So we define this on the server, and this is a query. So we ask, like, let's say, yeah, so this is a query, and yeah, and this is a query. They're pretty much the same, but this one takes the argument. So we ask for a project, and we want to get the tagline in return. So, and we also specify that we want to, not any project, but the GraphQL project. And this is it. And what we get in response? The same. So we end up with a project, with this JSON, and we've got the project that contains the tagline, which is a string. And it's pretty much that's it. So yet again, we have a client, and this client sends a request. That this request is being, resolved with, like, each field is resolved with data on the server side, and we get the response, and that's it. So those are the, yeah, let's say, most valuable clients of GraphQL. So Facebook, of course. GitHub recently opened, like, maybe not recently, but a few months ago, opened the API to GraphQL, so you can use the GraphQL, like, the API of GitHub using GraphQL. Also the Pinterest, and some other companies. But yeah, there are plenty of them, and they're still growing. So yeah, but why we use GraphQL? So let's get back to the example. So this is where we left off. We have this component, which is a container, which stands for smart component. We've got the logic here, and we even spread the logic. So we have this, we want to fetch the comment based on the comment ID, but we hide the actual logic, but the actual HTTP.get thing inside this class. Yeah, so let's take a look at this Counts API class. And it works like this. So you've got just a single method, and inside that method, we make a request, and we get the JSON object in return. And that's it, like, we can go. So let's implement GraphQL inside. I said that we can parse, like, GraphQL is just a query language, and we send just a string. So let's do this. What we want to fetch from here, we want to, not here. Yeah. Okay. So we want to fetch, a comment and an author. So how to do this and how would the query will look like? Just like this. So we have this comment which stands for the type on the server side, and we want to get the text of the comment and the author, which is inside the field of like post supply, and we like make an argument that I don't know. ID of the comment. So here's what. So let's put this into the service. We end up with something like this. Like there's an issue, but just imagine that it's all working. But we have got this query. We put the ID here. We don't even want to, like we want to, but we don't have to use this name of the query because it's okay, let's not talk about it, don't make it complicated, but we just put the query here, we assign the ID inside that that query, and we use this method called query to hit the server with the query and to receive the data so we can pass it to the single method. And, yep.
So you always have to write it in the string?
No, but you can use like, it's a string, and you pass it, like, so when you make a request, it is a string. Because
how do you validate it? Because if you write a string, there is no support from the...
This is, but we will talk about this later. But just to, briefly introduce it, it's a string, but when you use it on site, like with tools like Apollo, React, that kind of stuff, with Relay, it has to be compiled into the, imagine that this query is, when you want to build this manually, not as a query, but as an object, you have to use new GraphQL query and put the name of the query inside the constructor. And then inside the fields, the other arguments, you put this new field comment and you put name of the comment, that kind of stuff. And also in this, this nested object, you put the fields, and you just build the whole complex object that represents this query. But you can use, a string, and you can parse it into this object. So you get the validation. You don't even have to use the object to get the validation because it could be statically analyzed. So if it's a string and the IDE, which we will talk later, sees that this is a GraphQL. You can compare it with, we will talk about it in a minute. So back to the solutions. So how to solve those issues we talked about? We just did, but it's not true. We're using GraphQL, but it's not true. Yeah, I don't remember the slide, so it came up really awkward. So. Yeah, it's not the end, GraphQL is not a cure for everything, etc., etc. It's supposed to be funny, but, now it is, at least. So, let's talk about what we saw. So, by using GraphQL, we've got this separation of thing, so we no longer have to fetch the data we don't want to use. And when we change something on the server side, we don't actually want to reflect those changes inside the UI, so inside our apps. And yeah, this is what I said. And yeah, we want some data, and we get this data, nothing more, nothing less, just exactly what we need in any component. And also, we own the structure, so if you want to make an adjustment or some, or like we want exact shape, like this data in exact shape you want inside the UI component, we just define it this way and that's it. Which is impossible with REST endpoints, like with other endpoints. You would have to use custom endpoint or some parameter that, you know, presents the data and manipulates us. So we don't want to do this. But we can also use fragments. I mentioned this inside, like in the workshop. And fragments is, imagine a situation, oh, this is an example. So imagine a situation when you have the query to fetch the comments. And you have this part, like you always fetch ID, text, and author, and you don't want to repeat this. So you can, so this is what fragments does. So you can put this fragment, which represents, like, you can change something here, and it's applied here. So it's pretty convenient. And also, it's a good approach that every component defines your own fragment. So you can put this specific data into the query that fetches the data for all the components. Like, you know, so if you want the list of components, this is exactly, this is an API from the Apollo Angular library, but we will talk about this later. So our component needs the ID, text, and author. And we put this common info fragment with this component inside like one file or something like this, like, you know, to get the relation. And we have like a route that fetches the data and spread this into the component. So like this global state. So we pass this fragment to that query, and we no longer have to change this those ID, text, author things inside this query. So we just, you know, we manipulate, like we change it inside the component, and that's it. Like it's being fetched from the upper component automatically. So, okay. So we now talked about the data, the shape of the structure, like the shape of the structure of the data. But what about the network? So we can, like, we have still, because we use this, because we changed, like, because we still use for every component or every call of the single method inside this comments API, we use the HTTP request. So it's pretty much the same as it was before. We just, you know, change the way we fetch, like, change the endpoint actually. So we still have got this unnecessary request, but we can catch them all. So imagine a situation, like previously I talked that we've got like two components that hits the server with the same request. So we can wait a little time, let's say 10 milliseconds, so we can throttle them and catch the same ones. Let's say that we can convert each request into a promise or something like this. And we can share the same promise for those duplicates. So they share the same promise, so when we resolve it, yeah. So when we resolve the data to the promise, yeah, the same data is being shared between those components. Yeah, so it's basically a batching. And yeah, so we also solved the issue with the inconsistent data. So with batching, we don't even have to, like, all the same request have the same, like, have this, like, we, yeah, so we fetch the same data with the same request, so there is no, you know, differences. And yeah, but what about the overload network? So imagine a situation when you've got a route, and this is like, I don't know, route that says like route A, and we've got route B. And to get into the route that is called A, you have to fetch data from the server. And when you switch between those routes, you keep hitting the server. So we have to use some caching mechanism. You have like inside those routes a few pretty similar, even the same components. you keep hitting the server with the same request. So how to do this? We just use the cache mechanism. So we, on every request, we save the response to the cache. Like we hit the cache to see if there is a result. If there is not, we hit the server, we get the result, we save it to the cache, and then we update the UI. So next time, we no longer have to hit the server, we just get the result from the cache and we hit the UI. So it's like a basic kind of caching mechanism. But now our service is getting bigger and bigger, it's getting more complex, and as you can see, those issues are pretty much related to every project you basically done. So we are no longer alone, we can just, you know, open source it so people can help us improve the service and stuff. And it could be very helpful for many people. And what if I told you that someone did this and somewhere there is a magic tool and it's called Apollo. So let's talk about Apollo, which is a, so yeah, what is Apollo? Apollo is a GraphQL client. So it handles the, let me check it. Yeah, so it's exactly what we need. And it shares the, I keep learning the slides. So, so it solves all the issue we talked about. So we no longer have to, like, so we own the network now with this Apollo, like with Apollo, but what about the UI? So Apollo to the rescue. And yeah, so let's talk about the UI. So, which is pretty important to us because we use, like, we make apps for users. So, and as you all know, and like maybe not users don't like to wait, but anyone wants to like to wait. So, what to do with this? So, when we imagine a situation when we change the page, and when we request this change of a page, we have to fetch the data from somewhere, so we have to wait for the data, and now we can update the, we can switch to the route we wanted to. So, and there is a solution for this, and we don't like to see the loading indicators or blank pages and stuff like this. So we can use this feature of Apollo, which is called the optimistic UI. So, yeah. So. Okay, so this is a basic form for submitting a comment, and this is a list of comments. So without optimistic UI, we would have to type a comment, hit the submit, wait for the response, and then update the UI. But with optimistic response, we can predict the result because we just created the result. So it's like a list of comments. So we know the author because this is the author, like the currently logged user. We also know the text of that, like the content of that comment, because we just typed it. And we can put this inside the UI, send the request to the server, and when we get the response, we can compare it. And if it's the same, we can just leave it. And if it's not, we can just replace the old with the new one, and that's it. So it's pretty convenient because, as you can see, we get the result after we hit the submit button immediately, and we no longer, you know, boom, click, and we get the result. And then we get the actual response. So it's pretty convenient. So this is how it works. So we make an action, which is a mutation, or in GraphQL, or think of it as a post request or put request inside, like in REST endpoints. And we pass it through Apollo. So Apollo handles the network and all the stuff. And Apollo, we define the optimistic UI, the structure of it. So Apollo pass it into the Angular integration or the UI integration that changes the UI, the state of the UI. And in the same time, it hits the server to get the actual response. And then we pass this response to the UI. So this is what I just said a few seconds ago. Yeah, but how can we make our apps even faster? So let's think about latency yet again. So there's a cool feature, like not the cool feature, but cool approach, in my opinion. It's called prefetching. So we can predict, like we can predict the, no, let's not talk, so you show you the slides. So we can imagine a situation when we do know where user, like which page user wants to switch to. So we can use this. So yeah, so we have a link that says like that redirects us to a list of commands or list of commands. And this is like the example for the GitHub from GitHub example, GitHub example, which is a official example that is maintained by a whole team. And it's like pretty complex and it solves all the issues and stuff. So if you want to see how GraphQL works, just hit the Apollo GraphQL on GitHub and search for GitHub example. There is API and also React and Angular integration. So this is a page when we like have a list of something and we want to get the repositories and we want to enter the page with a list of comments for that repository. So this is a So when we hit the view comments link, which will be now, so user changes the page, we click, and now we change the page and we load the data. So it's a blank page. It's, you know, the latency is wrong, and we, after we get the response, we update the UI. So prefetching work like this. So we can, as you can see, when we point the cursor on top of this link, we can predict that user might or might not be want to change to that page. So let's take advantage of it and use prefetching. So user points to the actual link, and in the meantime we send a request. So we fetch this, like there is a query that fetches all the comments. So, and it's triggered when we enter the page. But what if we can trigger that query on mouse, like when user mouse over this element. So there we can use a cache. So when we hit the server with the data, we put this inside the cache. So next time, like when user actually clicks on this page, the data is already inside the cache. So there is another request when user enters the page, but because there is a result in the cache, we get the result immediately. So that's the like the, that's the whole point. And as you can see, whole app is just, you know, working so much convenient. Like, and we've got the result, which is pure magic. So we also want to use, like, how many of you uses Meteor or some tools like this? But you are all now probably familiar with real time things. So we've got in Apollo, in GraphQL in general, but I don't think that there is a support for subscription in Relay is a client like Apollo, but only for React. So Apollo is for Angular, React, Vue.js, stuff like this, and even Ember, Meteor, or just the vanilla JS. So we want this real-time experience to get the results immediately, so we can use subscriptions. And subscriptions inside the GraphQL works like this. So we've got an action. We do something. We use just a simple pub sub system. And we spread the result over the our clients. So, and this client makes a like request a query that is called subscribe, which stands for subscription. And this, because of this, he will get notified about the changes. So this is how it works. And what about the CEO? So how to make this even better? Like, there is Apollo, Angular Universal, and our integration of Apollo for Angular also handles the server-side rendering. So, and it works like this. So imagine a situation when you, or even like, let's say, so this is how it works, like blah, 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 you are familiar with server-side rendering, but here's an interesting part. You don't even have to render the page, like the whole application on the server side. You can use store rehydration. So imagine that your application, like the home page or the page you like user requested, have some queries. So you can cache these queries on the server side, like you know, execute them, get the result, put the result in some global state, let's say under window dot global state of Apollo and etc., and put this inside the HTML. And then when user actually enters the page, those results are already inside the Apollo, so it's already in cache. And later on you can, let's say, delay this request and it get the data from the cache, but after, I don't know, like 1 second, it hits the server to get the, like, you know, the latest state of those queries. And it's being updated like immediately, so it's not really visible to the user. And but it's still not enough. We can make it even faster, and this is why we end up with using ahead of time completion. So an Apollo, like the Angular integration of Apollo, is fully compatible with ahead of time completion. So it's a good thing. But what if I could tell you that we can fetch all, like we can make just one request per render? So we've got hundreds of components, and we don't make like hundreds of requests, we just make one. So this is how it works. It's called query fetching. So we get end up with one request per render, which is a pretty amazing. So in Apollo, you can specify these internal, and you remember this request fetching we did. And but now we handle this, like we catch all the requests. We put this in all the queries. We put this inside one huge query. We fetched and then we send this to the server. And the good thing is in GraphQL is that not right now, but in the future you could use something like you can prioritize things. So when you have like this huge amount of queries, you can say that, hey, I've got the currently logged in user immediately. And when you've got a list of comments and you want to fetch the ID and the name and the content of the comment, and later on the author, because author is not important or something like this, you can specify that this field is important to us, so return the partial data, and then later on update it with like the full data. So it's huge also. Yeah, but what about us developers? So let's talk about developer experience. And because the GraphQL is self-documented, we no longer have to maintain the separate ID documentation, which is code. And because of this, yeah, and this is, it's possible thanks to the introspection. So we can, as a developer, when you want to know, like, when you want to know what the endpoint does, you have to go into documentation, which could be a blank page. So, and it have to be keep updated, which is inconvenient. And with GraphQL and this introspection thing, you can ask the server, hey, what data you want, like what is the shape of the data, what are the types, and because of this, you can like display it like this. So you get all the information, and you get the documentation. And we can enhance the IDE thanks to the introspection. We get the whole structure of our schema, so we can, when we type something, this is what you asked me about validation. So when you have something like this query, the IDE already knows what is the fragment and what the data shares this repository type. So when you type something, you get the validation immediately, or even the auto-completion, which is like a huge thing. And yeah, that's it. And there are two ways of doing it. You can fetch for, like you can make the introspection, you can use it to fetch all the schema, save it to the file, and then, you know, just use it locally, or every time hit the GraphQL endpoint to see the introspection. Also see the schema, which is not pretty good. So yeah, this GraphQL is cool. And yeah, but what about the migration? You can use GraphQL with any endpoint, like any API you already have. This is how you can, because this is just a query language and it lives in between, you can hide the REST behind the GraphQL, and instead of putting those resolvers that you use inside the REST endpoint, you can, instead of using them inside the GraphQL resolvers, you can actually hit the REST endpoint or some other endpoint to get the data and pass it through GraphQL pipe. So yeah, and it's like, and it's possible to use even the REST endpoint with GraphQL, because, you know, it's just the way it depends on how you ask the data for data. And yeah, this is the migration. So yeah, so let's talk about frameworks. Like, it's not like Apollo or GraphQL in general, it's not only for Angular, React, Ember, Vue.js, anything. You can use, as I said, with any framework. And yeah, so I invite you to help and contribute with Apollo, or I don't know, especially with Apollo Angular. But yeah, help will be good. So it's enough. Yeah. So hit me with any question if you want. Like, if there's, do you have guys any? Yeah.
Yeah, there are some.
Sure.
You were talking about the real time subscription system.
Yeah.
Through the HTTP protocol or for example
WebSockets.
Okay.
So yeah, but
means that server should implement this way. Okay.
Yeah.
Could you switch to one of the previous slides? I don't know which,
but
that will come. I will tell you.
Okay.
Stop.
But problems or solutions?
Well, about the solutions.
Okay, so it could be like.
Yeah.
So this is the caching. Like. It will.
No, about the data inconsistency.
Oh. Okay. Yeah. It will be right. So how's your day?
Well, wait, I can describe.
Oh,
because
here?
You, it could be, but you showed us that when we have, for example, REST API, and there is that problem that, for example, you fetch the data, then there is some action, the data changes, you fetch it again, and there are some inconsistencies. Data. But the same situation basically occurs
In
GraphQL.
But on the server side.
Yes.
Yeah. But on the client side, you get it solved, like, you know, because of this. And yeah.
Maybe also because of this mechanism that you are waiting this delay. Maybe
you
are waiting 10 milliseconds and then there is only one request, so the data is the same because there is only one request to the server.
There is like there could be also an inconsistency in data, like between those queries. So even if you
the response will be the same.
Yeah, like imagine a situation when you get the, let's say, number of comments or number of likes, let's say, in two queries, or like let's say in three queries, two queries are the same, so they just as a one request. And like in some other request, there is a call for the same thing, but in, you know, in different query, like in different form and stuff. So even with this, you can get the inconsistent data, but on the server side, because, you know, you make a request to get this first request, and then you hit the server for those two queries, which are the same. So you end up with one request. So you've got still two requests, but for like pretty much. Like not the same.
These are all sequential, so doesn't matter for the server side.
Yes, but like that's true. Yeah, but you know, there might be a case when there is something changed, like, you know, immediately and in between those requests, even though that those requests are pretty much one after another. So, like.
Okay, it's really between those two the same requests.
Like those two the same queries are inside one request, because they are, you know, just it's the same query, but so it's the same query. So you fetch exactly the same query, but not the same data. Like you mean, you know, like you can.
So you are hitting the server with the one request with two the same queries.
No, no. It's like imagine you want to fetch the comment that has the ID. I don't know, 12, like two. So like 12, okay, 12 is good. And yeah, so you have two components that wants the data for this comments number 12. So this those two queries are like merged, not even merged, but one of them is being sent. But since they are the same, so they share the same result. So we no longer you no longer hit the server with the same exactly the same request with the same result.
You hit with the one request, with the one query.
Yeah, but let's say there is another query that is pretty much all in the same time, but this query, it's not comment specific, like this, it's not get the data for comment of my ID, item 12, but list of components, so you fetch all of them. So you fetch this data for comment number 12, but in two different places. And for two different use cases. So you still have to make two requests. But with this query patching in Apollo, you hit with one huge, like those queries are being combined. So it's not like one huge request, it's like one request that has all the queries.
And for example, those queries are not the same, they are similar. For example, you don't want to the name or author of the comment in one query, but all the other stuff are the same. They are also combined into one or not?
You can in Apollo, let's say you can use some middleware to handle the this data normalization. So you get in control of this caching mechanism. So when you do this. And like imagine a solution when you get a list of components and you fetch the like new component. So you get this component from subscriptions, let's say. And this is like another page, another separate thing. So it's not they not share the same query and stuff. So because of this data, because of this caching mechanism, and you can, you know, because of you, thanks to this manipulation, this manual manipulation, you can update that query and put this new data for comment number 12 to that query that you know fetches all the comments, list of comments. So you can, you know, and it's all lives in VS. So you can even let's say inject something that you want into Redux and keep in control of this stuff. So you can, you know. But yeah. But it's thanks to Apollo, not the GraphQL by itself.
Mm-hmm. And even it's more about the Apollo that solves all the problem, like prefetching also.
Yeah.
It's not the Apollo, it's not the GraphQL that solves this problem, but the Apollo.
Yeah, yeah. And also on the server side, when you hit, like when you want data for comment number 12, mm-hmm. let's say, so GraphQL server is so smart enough that, like, imagine that as I talked on Postgres, I love NG-Poznan. No, just kidding. But imagine, like, I talked about this on workshop when let's say every field, which is like, let's say ID or comment or item posted by, is resolved separately. So when you hit the server and you want like three times to get the data for comment number 12, you just execute it once because it's all inside the structure, like in the it's all been resolved, so it's good. I don't, so it's also, and you can do optimizations, even use cache inside this on the server side to, you know, like there's plenty of work to do.
One additional.
We've got plenty of time, so.
Okay.
So, should I just move the slides, or if you want to?
No.
It's okay.
Concerning this pre-fetching mechanism,
Yeah.
You showed us that if you will point to the link,
sure.
It will fetch prefetch data from the server. I imagine a situation that it will be not very efficient. For example, when you have a list of links,
yes, sure.
And you just will point but not enter the link,
scroll
through that link, it will make a lot of requests that won't be used.
Yeah, but it can also use, let's say, but like this is your implementation, mm-hmm. you know, so this is not Apollo specific, so you can handle, like you can catch those events, let's say mouse over or mouse enter, something like this, and wait a second, and if user mouse leave, like it, there is an event mouse leave, I think, and when it triggers, let's say, in this delay, so you can throttle the actual execution of that query. So you can handle that. Okay, we have mouse over, but this user already mouse like out. I don't know, left this, like mouse cursor left the actual element. So you can cancel this. You know, so you can. This kind of stuff. So if you scroll, you just, okay, I want to fetch this data, but wait a minute. Not a minute, it's not a good idea, but wait some time. And you see that, oh, key already points to another link, so let's cancel that. But this is just a example to, you know, to just, let's say, present you the whole idea of caching, because you can use this caching, which this idea, it's not mine, it's for Jonas, and the core developer of Apollo. And it's like mind-blowing because it's very simple, and you can increase the user experience of this application immediately, like just like this. And yeah, but the basic idea is to pre-fetch all the things that you might use later, because it's just a one request, so, you know. And on mobile, it's not possible, but you know, you have to predict this, like click on the link somehow, but there is no person. So, but you can like see that all these users spend a lot of time looking at this like one element in this center. So he might or might not enter the page after some time. So yeah, that's yeah. Any other questions?
You mentioned that in the query you don't have to define the, for example, mutation name.
Yeah, it's called operation name, because you can subscribe and stuff. So. Yeah, but
because when you are resolving the mutations queries, you should define that this mutation is, for example, for create and comment or something like that.
Yeah, but this is a name of the operation, mm-hmm. so it's not a name of the query. It's like it's name of the query, but you fetch some fields that are predefined on the server. So even if you don't use the name of the operation, so you just query something, you don't even have to use name, because those fields, like, I don't know, comments or like
all comments. It's only connected with the queries, because
yeah,
you're querying the world entities, like comments, users, or something like that.
Yeah.
Like when you are mutating something, you should precisely define what you are mutating.
Like, yeah, the name of the mutation, sure, but name of the query, right? Like name of the mutation you specified on the client side, you don't have to use that. Like it's not like name of the query, it's more like name of the operation. So if you query something, it's not named, the operation is named. So like this kind of thing. So even if you name the mutation, it's not like name of the mutation, because mutation is predefined, but it's name of the operation that makes the mutation. Like, and other, just kidding. But yeah, that's the point. And also, when you don't even have to use named operation, but it's recommended, because there's a cool feature. It's called persistent graph. You can see that inside your app you have, let's say, 100 of like 5 queries. So you can send those queries, like you can define those queries, exact queries with the exact shape on the server side. And you can just send ID of that query. So you can say that, hey, server, GraphQL server, I want to resolve data for query number one without sending the whole query, you know? And because the ID of that query, like this query and like this reference lives on both sides, you know? So it's pretty convenient because you just send the ID and you get the result and that's it. Like you don't have to that kind of stuff, and it's highly recommended to use it. Because, you know, all the query can get bigger in a situation when you've got this query batching. So we send all of the queries, and now you get, instead of 1,000 of characters, you send just like 5, because number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5. And, well, you know the idea, so that's the whole point. And also, when you have, like, to complete the this discussion over the name of the operation. When you use, there is some tool called Optics, and it's Apollo specific, like the GraphQL specific, like it's all GraphQL. So you can listen to the requests, and thanks to the name of the operation, you know that, oh, this operation takes like 1 minute to resolve. Like it's pretty bad because GraphQL is supposed to react immediately, but let's say there is an issue with this query because it takes too long, too much time. So thanks to the name, you know that, oh, this is this query and it lives inside this component. So let's fix the performance of that query of the component. So, and you can, yeah. So, and it, you can see what mutations, what fields slows down your application. Thanks to this Optics tool. So, and yeah, it's free for 30 days or something like this. And it's built by Apollo team. So, yeah. So that's. And also, thanks to the named operation, you get the data normalization. And we again say, shh. But, you know, you get the idea because it lives in the cache under the name, let's say, all comments or something. So, when you have the subscription, let's say, and you want to update something, and let's say this is not a named operation, so what we, like, how we supposed to know that you want to update this query? You can get the reference to the object that sends the query, you know, so this, like, function or something. Like this, there is an observable, so every time you want to fetch data from the Apollo, it's an observable, just like HTTP request and stuff, HTTP service in general, like in Angular. So you can get this observable and say that, okay, I want to update you, and that's it. But with the name operation, you can update it like separately. You don't even have to use the reference, you just use this name as a reference. So you say that, oh, after I done this mutation, which is a submitting a comment, let's push this comment, which I just submitted, to the list of components, list of comments inside, like for that query that is, let's say, list of comments query, something like this. And with optimistic UI, you just put this optimistic response, and instead of the actual response, you update the list, like update this query with that object. So this is how it works, and you update the query. So since this is an observable, the subscribe, so the next value is being emitted. So it's like this cycle. So you don't update the UI directly, you just update the, you just emit a new value. This kind of stuff. Yeah. I see you have many. Yeah.
This sounds of course good on the front end side, but I'm thinking about the back end. Do you know any implementation of implementing stuff to respond with the data we want? Yes.
Yeah, so there is Apollo created a, like, there is a integration with Express, so you can merge the GraphQL with the Express, like, pretty seamless, And Apollo also created a GraphQL server for like KOA Express and all the, you know, the web servers. So, and all you have to do is to define this, I show you this type, like, you have to define the schema. Hmm. Let's see what type. Yeah, I can show you somewhere here, but
schema and the resolvers.
Where is it? Oh, it will be, oh, let's say there is something worse. So let me show it to you. I don't know if it is here. It's supposed to be here, but you have to define something on the server. So you get the schema. Let's make it full screen. Okay, so you got the schema, and you also got the resolvers. And then when you make a request, you execute, like you match the field with a resolver to get the data, and then you send it back to the to GraphQL. So this is how a schema looks like. So you've got this type of user, query, mutation, subscription, anything, and this is like this is pretty important. So define this query, mutation or subscription, which is when you want to define query, you just put query, that's it, and you put the type. So you can, this is a root query. So when you make a, when you want to fetch data, let's say like we did project, and then we opened it to fetch the fields of that project. So if you want to fetch the users, you just type these brackets. You put the, like this could be just a query. So you put this, I want users, and then you specify with this brackets what fields you want, and that's it, and you get the result. And when you hit the server, it matches the schema with the query, so it tells that, oh, he wants to fetch the users, so it hits here, like for the query, because it's a query. So it hits the query. Oh, let's see if there is a user field, users field inside the query. Oh, there is. So here it is. And yeah, and so on and so on. And you can use, like, to fetch the users, it get the resolver for that users. So, and let's see if I have another slide. Yeah, so those are the slides from my workshop. So. And you get this query and those fields. I don't know if it's visible, I think so. So this is how you specify the resolvers. So you've got a query, which stands for this, and you've got user, which stands for this. And since this is an array of user-typed object, you just return something like this. And that method returns like the data for that part. Like, it might be complicated because we didn't, you know, introduce the GraphQL server side. But the whole idea is that you pass the data, and that data lives inside the, like, you can, let's say this is an array, so, and this is like one object. So every time, like for each element, let's say there are three users, so each user is being resolved with those resolvers. So, and since we get the data for all users just like in this method, we pass the method to the graph, and GraphQL is just like a graph, so you get like branches and leaves and stuff. So, and we check if, oh, on this branch we've got a name because we already fetched it, so let's reuse it, and that's it. So this is how, like,
so I can imagine that at some point it translates to, let's say, raw SQL query that is quite optimized, let's say.
Yeah, because, you know, it lives on top of the data sources, because like GraphQL, it's not for fetching data from SQL, it's to pass the data from SQL that you fetch by your own. So you, like all the MySQL queries and stuff, or any other data sources, lives under this. So you pass some data to GraphQL. So it might be a MySQL, or just anything you want. Like, you know, anything you want. But you have to provide this data to the resolver. how this resolver works and what is the logic inside this resolver, it depends on you. Like, it's totally up to you. So this is how, like...
Yeah, this all sounds great. I'm just curious about some difficult example. Like, you know, we are querying and including some data here and, you know, filtering some fields. That sounds nice. But when the more difficult example came up, I have a room reservation system and I want to check the rooms in some period and calculate the prices for them, etc. This is a quite complicated action on the backend side. Let's say, I was just thinking about how it's going to work with GraphQL and some abstraction over it. But
I recommend you to take a look at the GraphQL implement, like some basic implemented link. There is an example. It lives under the github.com/apollo-graphql/github-api, and it's a fully working, production-ready GraphQL server. And it has a list of GitHub repositories and also the comments for the repositories and stuff. So you can see, thanks to this, how the resolvers works. So, and then you can think of how I can, combine this what I have, which is a compilation of the prices and stuff, with this resolvers, and also what is the logic behind the resolvers at GraphQL. So you have like this path. So when you pass some data, you can reuse it or any like on each level you want. So you can imagine a situation where you have a room, let's say. And you don't have to fetch all the rooms, but you can like make a resolver that, okay, I want list of rooms. But then you can fetch each room separately, or fetch every one of them. Like, it depends on how you actually implement the logic and not the GraphQL itself. But you can take advantage of using this data from previous, let's say there is a point on the graph that has like this been resolved and has like nested like other branches. So you can get the data from the previous branch to reuse it inside from previous resolver on this branch, this tree of resolvers or schema of fields, and reuse it. So it's really up to you how you use it. So, but since Facebook uses it, and I think it's really possible. It's just it's just a matter of maybe not strategy, but the logic, like what is the structure of the logic, how it works and stuff like this. So, but yeah, because GraphQL is just to provide the data, but it also helps you with spreading the data. Yeah.
A bit naive question, perhaps, but
there is
I'm wondering because it sounds like a lot of trouble to implement this extra layer for GraphQL. You have to provide the resolvers, configure everything, and I mean the cost is quite high. Why is it better to use GraphQL rather than have a good contract with front to back end and translate the name of fields somewhere in the front end part? Because the thing we are talking about here, all the resolvers.
Yeah.
I have no working knowledge of GraphQL. I have no idea. it seems to me that you just take this field name translation from the front end, put it into a much bigger layer, intermediary layer of GraphQL. Why? What's the actual?
Yeah. So
is it just a separation of concerns, or is it just something else?
Like it's just a separation of concerns. Yeah. But also imagine a situation when you have a mobile app and a desktop app and web app, and they all share the same API, basically. But if not, you have to define custom endpoints for each one of them. With GraphQL, you just have one.
But, okay. Why do I have to define custom endpoints?
Because
first is the initial API. I have to provide separate endpoints anyway because I want to provide to get users, comments, posts, etc. So I do have to implement custom endpoints.
Yeah, but you know, like with mobile, you want to like it's not. You don't create something specific to a mobile or something specific to a desktop. You just you want to fetch the data on some site, like let's say on the client side. So you fetch the data on some device or some mobile device, etc. On some client. So you fetch exactly what you want, like nothing less than well, the same shape, and that's all. And you can fetch it inside one request. You can make like hundreds of them. You can make the nested request, and with REST endpoint, you keep hitting the server. Like imagine a situation when you want a list of components, a list of comments, let's say, a list of something. So you could have an endpoint that provides you all the information for that list, but you have to define another endpoint that gives you the information for just one single element. But with REST. Let's say REST, like the let's say with the proper REST approach, you have to have the endpoint that has the list of something, but it shares the IDs for some reference to that to like the information about how to get the data from that one element of that list. So you end up with one request, and then for each request for each element. Let's say this is just this is how GitHub and all the like this is the basic approach. So you can be like without this you have to use custom endpoint just to share the list of something. And it's not really reusable because you have to use you have to also define this custom endpoint that shares just data for one element, And this is specific.
Okay, I'm not sure I follow. What I understood is that you have to have a separate endpoint for a single element.
No. In GraphQL, you have one endpoint, which is.
But you still have when you want GraphQL is in the middle, right? So it's just an abstraction over the backend.
Yeah,
so the backend still has to be written.
Yeah.
This will have so you still have to have an endpoint for a users get all and users get single.
Yeah, but the whole idea is to get the separation of those things. So this is like
so
the whole
the
idea.
So the main benefit is the just separation.
Yes, but it's like this separation comes with few benefits, like the separation I think also, but you don't have to use like versioning and stuff because you don't have to use like change this endpoint to match this client you fetch the data from, because we just spread the data and your client. This is the main idea behind the GraphQL.
Okay.
So to fetch at like to fetch us at least amount of data and is at like to not do many requests. So
okay,
just to so this is like the basic idea. And just to the idea that stands behind the GraphQL, it was also to to maintain multiple application without keep changing the without keep changing those that applications after like on each change of the API. So this is like another like maybe not benefit, it's benefit, but this is like the idea behind GraphQL that Facebook wanted to resolve. So yeah, and if you get any questions, like if you want to explore this topic more deeply, you can get me directly on something. Like I would like to help you. So if you guys have another question,
sure. So in your opinion, what's the biggest challenge to become large with GraphQL?
Can you repeat?
What's in your opinion the biggest challenge to build something large in GraphQL?
That's the biggest challenge to.
What are the common issues actually that you might encounter with that?
So basic issue is with file uploading, because think of GraphQL not as some language, like it's a language, but it's more just specification. So it tells you how to do stuff. And currently, there is no information about how to handle file uploads, for example. So you have to somehow do your own implementation and do some magic tricks to, you know, send the file separately, and then when you get the response, like match this with this request, and, you know, save both of them, like, you know, with a reference or something. So it's, yeah, so it's the, like, for now it's the biggest issue. And also there is a issue with authentication, because it's not really specified, like, it, because this is just a query language, it's up to you how you use authentication. So it's not like some standard, or it's not being described inside. And at least if it's being described in the specification, it's so, like, so general talking that it's not pretty, like, there is no, they don't tell you exactly what you want to do, and, you know, what you have to do, and what are the principles behind authentication in GraphQL. It's just do what you want, like this kind of stuff. So, yeah. So this is like the few more things to being solved right now in GraphQL, and yeah, and even the subscriptions is not right now. It's not like there is a PR with whole description of, like, to put this into the official specification, but it's not being, like, it's not merged yet, but it's close to, because right now it's a discussion how to use it, like, what are the best approach and stuff like this. And you also have to, like, with subscriptions, you have to use some transport layer, and it won't be standardized, at least, because you have the specification of how GraphQL subscriptions work, but you don't have to use, like, WebSockets, you can use only internals, stuff like this, you know. So, yeah, so this is another thing that the community must, maybe not must, but yeah, I think so, have to resolve. So this is, yeah, another issue with subscriptions, because, yeah, because of this transport layer.
Okay. And the last question is, so this Apollo, it seems to me that it creates some quite substantial abstraction layer in your application. If something goes wrong with your application, and you get no idea what it's all about, how convenient is the debugging of this?
It's because you use Redux, and you get this all actions that is Apollo specific, like Apollo init, Apollo query, Apollo something like this. So you can, there is a tool for Chrome.
So basically you use this Apollo usually with Redux, right?
It's built in.
Okay.
And but they are working, it's like,
so
I
hope you can just try the action like normal Redux,
right? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So like the whole caching store is inside Redux, like it uses Redux internally, and the whole integration is bellissimo. So, and also I suggested them to make this Redux thing, so read and write from the store as an abstraction, so we could use GRX and, I don't know, OpEx and stuff like this. And they are currently working on it, but since there is a 1.0 release candidate of number, like, there is also, like, there is second release candidate for 1.0 version, and there is no still abstraction. Like, I don't, I was on vacation for 1 week or two, so I don't quite up to date with the 1.0 version. But there is a method, and it's called write to the store and read from the store, but it also uses the Redux internally, so there is no abstraction of the store, actually. There is abstraction of the write to, read from, but not the actual store, so I think so. Yeah, but I'm not quite sure if this PR has been merged or not. So since this is 1.0, we have to wait for 1.1 at least to get this feature of store abstraction. So, but back to your question, you can debug it as any other React or Redux-based application thanks to Apollo DevTools. And it's a plugin extension for Chrome. So, and you can see all the actions, all the queries, and all the things inside the store, and you can see how they are stored, and what are the, like, how normalization works and stuff. and see the current state of the application and even back to state thanks to the Redux timeline, you know, and back in time few actions, back and few actions. So I don't know if it fulfills your question, but yeah, okay. So if you guys have any other questions, so yeah. So hit me directly if you want. Like, yeah, I'm open for any question or if you want to just talk about GraphQL. Yeah, sure. And yeah, if you want to improve the Apollo Angular integration, keep free to just help us. Because right now I'm only one person and they want to, hey, Kamil, like Apollo, add something to us. Like, where is this, where is that, where is native script support? But, you know, I've got only two hands and we've got plenty of work to do. So if you want to help, yeah. And also, thanks to to extend the topic of the server, there is plenty of tools that, let's say you specify the schema and it creates the resolvers and stuff. Like, this is for a basic example, like, you know, but there is a tool that does that. Like, you know, takes the schema and creates a GraphQL endpoint create some basic example to know the GraphQL and to learn it and stuff. And you don't have to use like Express and etc. just to see how it works. Yeah. So that's the thing. And also, if you want to start using GraphQL right now without diving into server side GraphQL, like server side thing like GraphQL Express, like GraphQL Server and stuff, you can use. There are two tools. One is from Berlin. It's graph.cool. It's a backend as a service, so you define the schema and they provide you the GraphQL endpoint with all the actions like mutations and all the queries. So yeah, so you can use it just like this and it's pretty cool. It's like Firebase basically. So yeah, I think that's it if you want to. Yeah, no questions, everyone is tired, so yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.